Hello again. Our guest today can be said to be in step with the times, both past and present. She's not an historian nor a reporter. She is instead one of our foremost choreographers. Just back from her latest assignment in Estonia, please join us in welcoming the charming and talented Miriam Nelson. And now, here's your puckish man of the half hour, Skip E. Lowe.
You know, I came to Hollywood very, very young. I was like nine, just 29 years old. And my mother brought me to a studio, and my first film was with Jane Powell, Song of the Open Road. And from that, then I did another movie, many others, teenage movies, at Monogram for Maurice Duke. You know, I did a lot of films there. But then I left California and I went to Chicago. It was my favorite place. I grew up, I was 17, 18 years old. I became a comedian, nightclubs, you know. And my favorite place with Joni James and Shecky Green, we worked around Chicago nightclubs. And this lady I'm going to talk to, Miriam Nelson, from Chicago,
yes,
native.
Yes.
Tell me about, I love Chicago.
Well, I left there when I was too young to appreciate
it. Oh, really?
It too
How old
much.
Were you? Very
well,
young?
About 14.
14? You
know, I wasn't too sophisticated. But my mother was in charge of wardrobe at the Shea Paris in Chicago.
Oh, right.
So I saw every performer that ever worked there. You know, that was my favorite
thing.
Oh,
Sophie Tucker.
Everybody.
Some of these days.
Right.
And Joe E. Ross.
Joe E. Lewis.
Joe E. Lewis. That's right.
Right.
That's right. That's
they used to work together a lot.
Yeah, I love Joe E. Lewis.
Yeah, he was wonderful.
Miriam.
Yes.
Dancer. Started as very young, evidently, singing and dancing.
Oh, a little bit of everything. You had to.
Did you work clubs around Chicago at the time? Or
no,
little
I was too young. We would go out from dancing school and make $5, you know, to play
right,
a party
right,
or something.
Right, right. But you went to New York, did you?
I went to New York. My mother and father were moving to New York, and I studied there. I thought I knew everything about dancing when I went to New York because I'd studied with such a wonderful teacher. And I got there, and it was totally different. Where in Chicago I was learning buck and wing.
You right,
know,
tap,
but what
no,
a great
tap.
Foundation, you know, just flail your arms around a lot. And then I went to New York and I studied with Ernest Carlos, and it was all wonderful little taps, you know, very, very subtle.
First show.
Yes.
Theater. First, your very, very first. What was it?
Well, the first theater show was a show called Sing Out the News. Harold Rome wrote it. And I didn't know at the time, it was a very controversial show and a lot of politics in it, but I didn't know what I was singing about most of the time. But that
did
was
Did you study
fun.
Singing at the time when you were in
A New little York? Bit. Just a little bit. We all had to sing.
But how did you become a director choreographer?
Oh, God.
That word, choreographer. Can't believe that word. Ooh,
right.
That word.
No, well, everybody misses that one. And I think I mentioned that nobody knows what it is anyway.
What is it?
We
what
do.
Does it? What does it?
What does a choreographer do?
Not just tap.
Yeah. Oh, no. No, you have to know how to do really everything. I've had to learn every kind of dancing. If I don't know it and I get a job, I go out and have to learn it, whether it's clog dancing or Irish now, which is so popular.
What made made you do it?
Start. Maybe dance?
Yeah, no. To
Or
to
just choreograph.
Choreograph.
Well, I didn't really think about it. I was going to be a star. I wanted
oh,
to
you
be
wanted
Eleanor
to be a
Powell.
Oh,
sure, that
okay.
was my goal. And I was in shows, Broadway shows, and somehow a choreographer would always say, oh, come here, Miriam, do this step with
help
me,
you.
Or
right.
you know, help me, or assist me.
Yeah.
And I assisted a lot of wonderful people. No credit, but what a great foundation. Bob Alton was my favorite, you know, and he went on to do a lot of wonderful movies with Fred Astaire. And.
But you came to Hollywood very young out here to California.
Yeah.
You signed a contract with Paramount Studios.
Right.
Tell me about that.
Well,
you did
I
a
really,
lot of films as an actress,
oh,
not
yeah.
just as a dancer, but
oh,
as
little
an
bits,
actress.
You know, never major, major, but I did a lot of them, yes. When I came to California, I was here on a vacation. Uh-huh. And the first day I was here, I ran into a dancer that I knew from New York. Uh-huh. He was now working at Paramount Studios, and he said, oh, you must come tomorrow, and I'll take you to lunch, and you'll see how they make movies.
Right.
So I did, and we went to lunch, and I could hardly eat. You know, I'd put the spoon up and see Ray Milland or Alan Ladd or, you know, all these wonderful-looking
people. The commissary was full.
Oh, it was filled with gorgeous people. And as I was leaving, I heard this man's voice say, hey, Franklin. And I turned around, and it was a man sitting at a big table up front,
right.
Buddy DeSilva. Oh. He was the producer of the next to the last show that I was in New York.
Right.
And he was now the president of Paramount Studios.
Right.
And he said, you know, what are you doing out here? I told him, and he said, you want to go to work? So I said, sure. Uh-huh. So he told my friend dancer, who he knew, to take me up to the business office in about a half an hour.
Right.
I went up and I signed one of those 7-year contracts.
You got a 7-year contract?
Well, they all were. It was kind of a stock thing. You know, they had the option. They could pick you up or leave you every year.
But they send you to school when they send you a 3.
Well, they didn't at Paramount. I started working
20th,
right away.
Yeah,
20th, I think,
MGM,
did.
I think,
MGM always had schools.
Yeah.
In fact, they even talked to me once about, after I'd been there a while, about teaching style and things to the young gals, and I was very young myself. But
I did a movie when I was a kid here, one of the great, the original Jolson story. I was singing in that film.
What'd you
as
do?
A
Which
little
part?
Boy in the choir there, the
oh,
little, in the
sure.
temple, the little Jewish boy singing
of course.
With the yarmulke. And yes. you were in the film.
Well, you know what we had in common.
Yeah, we have. But you were in this movie with Eleanor Powell, Evelyn Keyes.
Keyes, right.
Tell me about Evelyn Keyes. Because she was afraid when she was dancing the number of Liza.
Yes.
She couldn't look down.
Well, I have to tell you the story. I was hired to choreograph the number for her.
For her.
And I spent several weeks on the soundstage with the playback man. They'd already recorded the music with Al Jolson's voice on it.
Right.
And so it was, how many ways can you come down a stair dancing, you know, tapping? One day I get the message, they're coming, to see the number.
Right.
And in came all these chairs and ashtrays and things, and Harry Cohen, the head of the studio,
right.
Al Jolson, the director, the producer, Evelyn.
That's right, it was at Columbia Pictures.
That's right.
That's right.
So like 12, 15 people filed in, and my heart started pounding. And then at one point they just said, go on, let's see the number. Uh-huh. Nobody introduced me to anybody. I just did the number.
Right.
So when I finished, I'm waiting for a reaction of some kind, and I see them all huddled. You know, they're all looking to Mr. Cohen, I guess to see what he thought first, I don't know. Uh-huh. And then they had a big conference, and then he called me over and looked at me closer, and then he said, Evelyn, stand up next to her.
Uh-huh.
So Evelyn did, and then they had another conference, and then he said to me, would you double her? So surprised, you know. So I said, I guess so, sure. Uh-huh. And so they had a costume made for me and a red wig. It was kind of an updo.
Right.
And I shot the number. So Evelyn really was only in the very beginning on a close-up.
On the close-up, right.
And then they told me, I was just told, you come down about 3 stairs, you have stage fright, you almost fall, and you get scared, and then you hear Jolson's voice, and he's in the audience, which you don't know, and then you're revived. And so in when I do my little cruise that I told you about, when I tell this story, I say, well, I did the dance, but she took the bows.
She took the bows, right.
Right.
Well, let's show my audience of this from the Jolson
story. Oh, I must tell you, too, that they cut the taps out because they thought his voice was more important. And here it was a big tap dance.
They did.
And I had already recorded all the taps, and they took them all out.
They took it out, just kept Jolson's voice in.
Right.
Let's listen to this, okay?
Okay.
Good, from the Jolson story.
Sure.
Liza, skies are gray, but if you smile on me, all the clouds will roll away. Liza, Liza, don't delay, come keep me company, and the clouds will roll away. Clouds are all away.
smile on me, all the clouds are all away. Liza, Liza, don't delay. Come keep me company, and the clouds are all away. See the honeymoon are shining down. I just made a date with Parson Brown. Liza, Liza, name of the day. When you belong to me, all the clouds will roll away.
Interesting, Larry Parks. And people didn't realize that was you dancing.
No.
They didn't advertise you at all about this.
No,
they
not
would
at
never
all.
They never do those days.
They don't
days.
Want anybody
they don't
want to know.
To know they're no. singing and dubbing. That no. whole movie was dubbed.
Oh, yes. From, that's know? Right. Larry's that, voice.
Larry's
it was
voice.
All Al Jolson.
Al Jolson, yes.
Sure, sure.
Al Jolson was great. He was alive then.
Yes. Yes, he did a little shot in that movie.
He did, yeah.
Yeah, there was a long shot out yeah. on the ramp.
I remember him very well. I met him at the radio station. Just mm-hmm. very brief, very brief. He was wonderful.
Yeah. And he did a little funny tap step sort of thing.
Uh-huh.
And they had me go and watch that so uh-huh. that I could learn it and teach it to Larry Parks. Uh-huh. So
he was a great guy,
that.
Wasn't he?
Larry?
Yeah.
Oh, yeah. I love Larry.
I do,
he
too.
Was so he, sweet.
Yeah.
Such was, a sweet man.
Tell me about sweet, I love the daughter of Rosie O'Grady. Tell me about, is that 20th?
No, that was Warner Brothers.
Was that, oh, that's right, Warner,
Warner
Brothers.
Warner Brothers.
Who was in that?
Oh, gosh.
I always think of sweet
June
Rosie O'Grady,
Haver.
June Haver, that's correct. I always
right,
think of Betty Grable.
Debbie Reynolds, I think it was her first movie. And I always think of Debbie selling her Girl Scout cookies to everybody.
Was that her first film?
I think it was.
Uh-huh.
I think
uh-huh.
it was, yes.
And who else was in that? Dan Daly wasn't in that.
No, my first husband, Gene Nelson.
Gene Nelson. Is yeah. that where you met Gene Nelson?
No, I met Gene in New York. He was an ice skater when we met, and I was working in a Broadway show.
Which
and
one was that?
And then he came out here. Which show
which
was
show
he
was,
in?
No, which show were you in?
I was in Panama Hattie.
Oh, right.
And then I said we met in Panama Hattie and married in Let's Face It, which yes. was Danny Kaye's show
Danny
that Kaye's was
show.
Next. Yes.
Right.
Yeah.
Gene Nelson, you were married for a long time.
11 years. Uh-huh.
11 years. Matter of fact, I understand when he, I interviewed him.
Did you?
He was wonderful. Uh-huh. Yes. He was working, he was teaching in Oakland.
Oh, yeah.
At the time.
Yeah, he was.
And just before he died, he came and did my interview, and he was just wonderful.
How nice.
And I understand that you kept very good friends
yes,
till
we
the
were,
end.
As a matter of fact. Yes.
And matter of fact, you were there at the side when he died, I understand.
Yes, I was. And our son.
Yeah, you have a son.
Yes,
I
we have
know
a
that.
Son.
What does he do?
He's an editor, a film editor,
uh-huh.
and he does wonderful things. He's been nominated several times.
His name is?
Chris Nelson.
Chris
Christopher
Nelson.
Nelson.
Where is that love affair? Must have been really a hot love affair between you and Gene, because you both,
oh, yeah.
you both danced together. In
yes. Well, I assisted Gene on a lot of those movies at Warner Brothers.
Uh-huh.
I didn't really.
That's
become
right. You,
known
I
myself until after we
Virginia
broke up.
Virginia Mail. You did a movie with
right.
Virginia Mail, working through college.
Working your way through college.
That's right.
Yes.
Of course, that was a good movie.
Yes, it was.
I Warner
it was
Brothers a, didn't.
Ronald Reagan was in that one.
Was Ronald Reagan in
it? Yes, yes. He played a teacher.
Uh-huh. Uh-huh. Oh. Warner Brothers doesn't usually do musicals. They're a very dramatic studio.
Well,
isn't
I guess
it?
They were, but they did their share.
Well, Jimmy
they
Cagney.
Did their share. Cagney,
yeah.
yes.
Yeah.
He was wonderful. He used to come and hang out and watch all the time when we were rehearsing.
Oh, really?
Yeah, he loved dancers.
He's a great dancer.
Oh, he was wonderful.
Yeah. You get
he had
a
crazy kind of a style, you know, but. He
but he was
good.
Masculine.
That yes,
was
very.
A very masculine
very.
Style. Gene Nelson was masculine, too, as
yes,
a dancer.
Yes, he was. In fact, the movie you're talking about, Working with the College, I think the best number, one of the best all-time numbers I've ever seen was in that. He did it in a gymnasium.
Uh-huh.
And people thought there was a double for him in that, which wasn't. He did all his own work.
Bob Hope and Bing Crosby, tell me
yes.
about that. You were at the Easter show for the Radio City Music Hall.
Oh.
Tell me about Radio City Music Hall.
Well, the Easter show.
That was, go ahead.
Let me think. It was, that wasn't with Bing. It was, Bob Hope had, all right, I have to go back one step.
Okay.
I did the Academy Award show.
Right.
And it was on bicycles. And
right.
that's a long story. But I got to have like 12 couples on bicycles.
Uh-huh.
And it was based on Butch Cassidy and the Sundance
right,
Kid. When
right.
I went to the movie and saw him showing off on a bicycle, I said,
right.
oh, that would
that
be fun.
Good
you know?
Scene, yeah.
And Mike Frankovich was our producer, and he allowed me to do that.
Uh-huh.
And then Bob Hope was the one that introduced the number on the Academy Award.
Uh-huh.
The next day I got a call from the head man at Radio City Music Hall in New York, mm-hmm. and he said, I just saw the number, would you come and stage that for our Easter show?
Mm-hmm.
So I went to New York and staged that number with his people,
mm-hmm.
Or the music hall people.
Mm-hmm.
So that was wonderful.
But you staged a lot of things for a lot of people in this town of Hollywood, Carl.
Oh, yeah. Right.
Edie Gourmet and Steve Lawrence, you put thing together.
You're right. I've done several
television
acts for
shows.
Uh-huh.
And Donald O'Connor, too.
I did Nightclub Act for Donald. Yes, we had eight girls surrounding him and doing a lot of dancing.
One of the great dancers of this town.
Yes. And one of the nicest.
Yeah, I went to school with him just for a brief time at the HPS
mm-hmm.
on Hollywood Boulevard off of Western Avenue. It used to be a wonderful little school.
Oh, I'm trying to think
the
which
HPS.
One it was. HPS.
Yeah, Hollywood Professional School, right
course,
on Western, off of Western Avenue
and
on Hollywood
Prong.
Boulevard. That's
he
correct.
He used to work with...
Absolutely.
In fact, Louis DeProng got me my first job in television.
Really?
Yeah, as a choreographer. Yeah.
What did you like? Television or movies better?
Oh, gosh.
What's harder?
Well,
what is harder?
Harder is television
because
it's so fast.
Yeah.
Used to do weekly shows, you know, and
Dean Martin.
Yes.
Done many
Dean shows, and I used to look at the watch and say, "How much more time do I have for how much more music do I have to fill?"
Right.
You know, that's kind of the way it went.
Alan King, Tony Newley.
Yes, they did Caesar's Palace. They both did their acts, but they had a number specially written for them.
Uh-huh.
And so I was hired to stage the number for them.
Mm-hmm.
They were fun. I had a great time working
Tony
with
Newley
them.
Was great.
Oh, yes. Tony was such a perfectionist, you know. He said, if I do my whole act for you in a rehearsal hall,
uh-huh.
if you just come up with any little gimmick at all, I'll appreciate it. And he did that.
Uh-huh.
And I came up with one little funny idea with the microphone that he could do, and he liked that.
What's been the hardest for you as a choreographer in Hollywood? Because
oh my goodness.
There are many here. There are many.
There
You're not
are.
The only one. There are many.
Yeah.
But
and there are more and more and more,
and
you
more.
Know, and all
yeah.
these young ones doing hip hop and all of
yeah.
that.
Yeah. What do you think about that?
Well, I think it's a fad. I think they're wonderful dancers,
uh-huh.
but they don't, most of them don't have a real foundation in dancing, and if they ever change the style, I don't know what they'll do,
uh-huh.
you know, because you really have to learn to do everything.
True.
Uh-huh.
You also CHAIR. Tell me about CHAIR, this wonderful organization that you found.
Well, I'm one of,
The founders.
There were five, and then there were two right away, so we always say there were seven.
Who are they?
You. Jeannie Martin, Dean's wife.
Jean Martin.
Sheila McRae, Gordon's wife. She actually called me and said, one of our friends is in trouble. Her mother is very ill, and her husband is cheating on her, and I think we should have her over for lunch and talk about things and get her out of the house, you know, just get her mind off of it. So we did. And Gloria Franks, who was Sammy Kahn's wife at the time, and Paula Blythe, was, her husband had pins, I believe, and Marge Chandler, Jeff Chandler's wife.
Of course.
Well, at any rate, we all showed up for the luncheon, and the lady it was given for never showed up. And so, to this day, she or her husband, they never knew what happened. But during lunch, we just happened to casually say, what could we do that would be good, you know, something nice. And the first thing we thought of was collecting magazines for the old soldiers' home.
Right.
And so Sheila's father took them out there. And then we did a few more things. Then we got baskets for needy people at Christmas time.
That's wonderful.
And it started
it's a great organization.
Just so small. And
yes.
now we raise millions of dollars.
Yes.
And we help. We have 40-some facilities
that
we are in charge of. You know, not charge, but I mean we finance and give them money for things they need desperately.
Right.
Yeah.
What has been the way for you for dancing?
Oh, for dancing.
Yes.
Gosh, all dancing is joyful to me.
All dancers love.
Oh, yes.
They love it, don't they?
Yeah, I think there's, I don't know, I go and watch a ballet class, and they're all very stern, you know, and working. And you go watch a tap class, and they're just having the best time. So I think tap has been the wonderful outlet for me.
Uh-huh. Sesame Street. Tell me about Sesame.
Oh, my
One of my favorite guys. I love this guy. Jim Hansen.
Oh, so did I.
You did some things with him.
Yes.
Tell me about the Muppet.
Well, curiously enough, those little Muppets were big Muppets when I did the show. It was a traveling arena show.
Mm-hmm.
And Bob Shipstead, whose father was part of Shipstead and Johnson, the ice show.
Right.
And he hired me to do this. And
you
we
did
had,
an ice show, didn't you?
I did one for him, too, at Radio City.
Yeah, Radio City Music Hall.
Yeah,
Go
he
ahead.
Hired me
that.
To do that,
yeah.
too. But the Muppets were such fun.
I got to know them all, you know. And then I was doing another show at the same time, and I was in Japan with the Playmates, the Playboy Playmates.
The girls who, the Playboys. Oh, the Playmates. Okay. We'll talk about that in a minute.
We're not going to have enough time for all this conversation.
Okay,
at any rate, I got a call while I was in Japan. Could I come back a few days early and come to Canada, because Jim Henson was shooting a movie there, and he would have Sunday off, and he could record the voices of all these characters that we had staged. And so I did. What's the other man's name? Oh, goodness, he's become a good director, too. But the two of them would do Bert and Ernie, and he used to do Kermit the Frog, and a lot of those characters. Well, it was wonderful to see these older men with white beards, you know, and they're acting so silly.
Silly for kids.
Just silly
because
for kids.
Because they're one big kids.
Right.
They really are. Miriam Nelson, tell me about your, I mean, you keep yourself busy.
Yes.
Why do you keep yourself so busy? You're in one town here, and then you're saying the Playboy, Playmates. What's that all about, the Playmates?
The Playmates, well, one of the girls was going with...
This was in Manila, too, in the Philippines?
Yes, yeah, we went over there. One of the girls, Sonny, was going with Mr. Hefner at the time.
Oh, okay.
And they used to sing around the piano, a group, and they thought it'd be fun to have a little nightclub act. So an agent that I knew called me and said, come and see, you know,
and
the girls.
Stage it,
And so I worked forever on that. I got a lot of money, Mr. Hefner, thank you. But they started from scratch. They never danced. They didn't really sing.
Is it difficult for people, for you to work with when they don't dance?
I mean, I get a lot for some reason. I don't know if every choreographer gets as many as I do, but I get a lot of people who have never danced before, and I have to make them look like
they're dancers.
This last job, I had to teach Keith Carradine how to be a song and dance man. He had never tapped in his life. He was in Follies, but they never danced, really.
Didn't I see him in the Broadway thing?
Yes, what Follies.
The Follies?
Yes, the Will Rogers Follies.
The Will Rogers Follies,
but believe it or not, he never really danced.
Do you put that to help them with that, then?
Well, not the Follies, but I worked with him to make him a dancer for this movie I just did. And he came to Estonia, Tallinn, Estonia.
Where is that?
So many people say, where is that? It's between Finland and Russia.
Okay.
It's right in the middle. It's its own country. At one time, it did belong to Russia.
Okay.
It did belong to Germany, I'm told.
They were filming
now,
there?
Yes. Yeah. We just finished filming over there. But Keith worked so hard. And he said it was out of fear, because he had to really learn in a very short time. And I tried to show him how to fake things, because I said, I'll put the taps in, which I still have to do yet when they get it all put together. And he said a funny thing, because he said, I told him I dubbed for a lot of people, even Crosby and Hope, if you want to go way back. But I used to put their footsteps in, you know, or Betty
Hutton. Of course.
And he said, what are you, the Marnie Nixon of the tap feet? Which I thought was funny, because Marnie used to sing for everybody.
Right.
So, but Keith was wonderful to work with. And there were a lot of really good people in that movie, but nobody really that had to know how to dance could dance. And... may I go back to the Muppets for a moment?
Yes, you certainly
I made a tap star out of one of the Muppets, like a Ginger Rogers with the feathers and everything, and I had 8 or 10 monsters behind her in top hats and tails, and we did a whole tap number just like it was out of a movie.
Right,
we did it for real, and then I dubbed the tap. Their feet, you know, the monsters' feet are humongous.
Big, yes.
And yet I dubbed each one, you know, and made it sound like they were doing it. Everybody thought it was fantastic that they could tap like that. They don't know. You know, the audience is
I want to show my audience the first. I think this might be one of your first movies.
Which one?
Well, I'm going to show you tap dancing with right now. The movie I'm going to
show. Oh, is that Duffy's Tavern?
Duffy's Tavern.
It is very early, in my career.
Early on. Let's go on. Let's see this wonderful film, you tap dancing from Duffy's Tavern.
Okay.
Thank you.
That's wonderful.
Well,
Mary, God, looking at that, when you, what do you think of when you're looking at back at that? The work went through it.
The work was wonderful, and the excitement of seeing the sets being made.
A book. Tell me about a book. Hey.
Well, I finally wrote it.
You've taught many people. You've put them together.
Right.
Got to be in a book.
It came really out of the cruise ships that I've done now with all the stars, and people say, my God, you work with so many stars, you should write a book about it.
Right.
And it kind of threw me into it, and I started, and every chapter is about a different star that I've worked with, and my stories, you know, they're not anybody else's, just mine.
So, I'm looking at you. Did you have a good time, Mary?
Oh, I had a great time.
Really?
You mean in life,
in general? Yeah.
Would you do it this?
Would you do it the same way, or
well, I wouldn't make silly mistakes.
No, we all make mistakes.
I would be smarter,
you know.
Sure.
Frank Sinatra. Tell me about. He worked on Cher with you, the wonderful organization.
Oh, he did many, many shows. He was wonderful. I always think back to one time when we had a fashion show auction, and we had this wonderful coat to be auctioned off, and the girl was backstage. Well, all of a sudden, out came Frank in the fur coat and the tiara.
Oh, really?
Auctioning off the coat. And then we had the Rat Pack.
He helped a lot of people.
Oh, many.
Great.
Many, many people, yes.
Great entertainer.
Yes.
One of the best.
And he would show up for Cher parties for, you know, years and years. He did it. He was wonderful.
It's a great organization. I love that organization.
So.
And you guys are doing a great job. God bless you both.
We have so many wonderful members, you know, that are really working so hard all the time. And we do all our own work. We don't have any paid people out there working for us.
That's great.
Yes.
Thank you, Marion.
Thank you,
God
Skippy.
Bless you,
I enjoyed being with you today.
Hello again. With us today, we have an actor, director, dancer, choreographer, and ice skater, all in the person of our one guest, the star of Follies, Londoner, Lullaby of Broadway, Oklahoma, Ad Infinitum. He's the ever-popular Gene Nelson. And now, here's your man of the half hour, Skippy Lowe.
Gene Nelson, living in San Francisco.
Yeah, Skip, I'm up there now.
Doing what? You're teaching, I understand.
I'm teaching at San Francisco State.
Uh-huh.
And theater arts,
right?
And which is acting and directing and all that stuff.
Uh-huh.
And I love it.
Do you realize, how long have you been up there now doing that?
Let's see, last September.
Really?
My first semester was started in September.
Uh-huh. Working with these young kids.
Yeah.
Boy, a master, 50 years in the business. I mean, come on, 50 years, Gene Nelson.
Yeah.
You look 50. You look fantastic, really.
Yeah, well, thank you.
Gene Nelson, where did Gene Nelson come from originally? Where?
Seattle, Washington.
Uh-huh.
Born there. Left there after 1 year, I was told. I don't remember it, of course.
Uh-huh.
Moved to Oregon, Astoria, Oregon, where my mother's family was.
Uh-huh.
Stayed there a year, and then moved to Hollywood at on Orange Grove Avenue.
Orange Grove.
Yeah. And my dad was a machinist.
Uh-huh.
And during the early part of our stay on Orange Grove Avenue, things got a little bit, this is we're talking a long time ago.
Right.
We're talking, you know, the late 20s here. And things, jobs weren't too easy to find. And so Dad answered a call at the Douglas Fairbanks studios. To be an extra, $5 a day and a box lunch.
Uh-huh.
It was better than nothing, you know. And he worked on that for a week, and they put him in rags. Remember the Thief of Baghdad?
Yes.
Remember the flying horse?
Of course.
The big crowd scene, 1,000. Uh-huh. They had 1,000 extras in that thing. I mean, the old, and it was terrific. And of course,
so you actually grew up in the films?
No. Dad, I mean, that was a desperation move. I mean, he was trying to feed his family, right?
Uh-huh.
It was very exciting because when the picture did come out, we all had to run and go see Dad, right?
Uh-huh.
The shot came that he was in, you know, like a sea of people. You couldn't tell one from the other. No way.
That's funny.
But it was fun. Just know he was there, you know.
What's the first film or theater that Gene Nelson did? Do you remember? What was your first job?
My very first job. My very first job was, I mean, for money.
For money. Theatrics.
Was the Paramount Theater downtown with the Fancher Marco Juvenile Review, $15 a week.
Really?
Yep. And at that time, Fancher Marco had a lock on the Paramount.
Uh-huh.
They had the Fanchonettes.
Right.
Like the Radio City of New York.
Right.
But out here, it was called the Fanchonettes, which is a chorus line. And they had their show with a big, you know, a 28-piece band.
Right.
And a guy named Wolf was the director. Conductor, and that show, you know, was like all year round.
Right.
They'd run a movie, you know.
Yes.
Three or four shows a day.
Yes.
Fancher Marco, was tied into that.
Uh-huh.
So every Easter, summer, and Christmas, the Fanchonettes would get a 2-week vacation, and we would work all the whole year putting on a show that would replace them.
Right.
You see? So at that time, Rita Hayworth was named Rita Cancino, and her father, Eduardo, was teaching Spanish dancing. You know,
uh-huh.
Dance, mm-hmm. And she was assisting him. Uh-huh. I only found this out later. Uh-huh. You know.
Did you study in New York dancing when you were in New York as a young man?
I studied very briefly with Hanya Holm.
Uh-huh.
This was much. I mean, after most of my serious study was out here. I'm not that Hanya wasn't serious. I took from Nick Castle out here.
Right.
When Nick was, you know, he was a real fine choreographer for many films, you know. And my first teacher was a guy named Steve Granger, who lives now in the San Francisco area. He's quite old, he's a former performer.
Yes.
He taught me the old Bill Robinson routines.
Uh-huh.
You know, from Bill's records. Because he put all his stuff on records. And there were three, I think.
But Fred Astaire had a lot to do with Gene Nelson's career. Am I correct?
I got him to blame for it all.
Go ahead.
Really?
Yeah.
If I hadn't, that Saturday afternoon, I don't know, it was summertime, I think, I was 12 years old, and I usually went to the Wilshire Theater in Santa Monica on 14th Street, and it's a Saturday matinee, right? I mean, doesn't everybody, you know, at that age,
right.
And they were playing Flying Down to Rio. I watched that. I couldn't believe the wonderful beauty and the rhythm. I mean, I got out of there and I.
You danced out of the theater.
I danced all the way home. I mean,
really?
I don't know if you could call it dancing, but I mean, I did what I thought was dancing. And my mother and father, they said, "What are you doing?" I said, "Oh, and so for the next few days, I was all over the house doing this, mostly on Mother's hardwood floors. That's a
no-no. Don't do that.
She didn't need that. She says, if you're gonna scratch up my floors, we better give you lessons, right? So I started taking
dancing
every Saturday.
And that's where Gene Nelson really became.
In Santa Monica, California, right?
California. Yep. Gene, Oklahoma, come on. The wonderful Broadway show. Oklahoma, you were in.
Yeah. I was in the Broadway show.
The movie.
The movie
I'm talking about. That was a great movie.
What an experience.
Gordon McRae. You've done several things
Gloria
with Gordon.
Graham. Oh, yeah, well, we were under contract at Warner's together. At Warner's.
Warner's?
Yeah, with Doris right. Day and Virginia Mayo and, you know, all those people.
Was Virginia under contract at Warner's?
Oh, yeah, I did three pictures with Virginia.
Working your way through college?
Working through college, right. With Ronald Reagan.
Ronald Reagan. Yeah. Tell me about working with Ronald Reagan at the time.
Well, he was fun. I mean, at the time, he was president of the Screen Actors Guild.
Right.
And he and Don DeFore and I, we had a good time making the picture. Really fun.
Was it great working at Warner's at that those years?
It was. I felt very homey there.
Did you?
I felt very comfortable there. Except for times when I didn't think they were giving me enough to do, and, you know, you have your little temperamental.
You worked three movies with Virginia Mayo.
I did three with her, and I also did three with
Doris Day.
Doris Day.
Tell me about Doris Day. I like her. Do you still see her? She lives in your area, doesn't she?
I haven't seen her in, let's see. Well, I saw her about a couple of months before she moved up to Monterey.
Right.
Or Carmel, I guess.
Uh-huh. Where she lives near you.
I went over to her house in Beverly Hills, and I had an idea for a script for her to do with Rock.
Uh-huh.
You know?
Rock Hudson.
Yeah. And she found it a little bit difficult to talk because she had her 25 dogs were, you know, always in the way, you know.
Uh-huh.
During our tenure at Warner's,
uh-huh.
We used to go at lunchtime when we were shooting, uh-huh. right, or rehearsing. She had a house in Toluca Lake right across the street from the studio practically.
Right.
And so her mother would cook this tuna fish casserole for uh-huh. us, and my ex-wife, Miriam, and I, and would go over for lunch,
uh-huh.
you know what I mean?
Uh-huh.
I don't remember any, they may have had a dog, I don't remember, but all of a sudden, I don't know if all of a sudden or not, but anyway.
Gene, you have some fond memories of Hollywood, don't you?
Yeah, I do. I have some bad memories too.
Well, it's changed a lot, hasn't it?
Yeah, and not for the better.
Not for the better. Because the star on Hollywood Boulevard, when you see those stars on Hollywood Boulevard, how dirty they are! That street is so dirty.
Hollywood Boulevard
has always been that
way.
Was
never a clean street.
Right.
I mean,
right.
It was the name itself. Too bad they didn't start thinking about cleaning it up. You know.
Then.
40 years ago,
you know,
because what it represents, Hollywood Boulevard, to the world, you know,
yes.
I mean, to everybody else, they people used to come out here thinking it was paved with gold.
Yes, yes.
They really did. Uh-huh. And because our business is an illusionary business,
uh-huh.
I mean, we all create illusions
yes.
for people, and they believe them.
Uh-huh.
They believe those illusions.
Uh-huh.
And I'm afraid the... politics of uh-huh. Los Angeles has left much to be desired
right.
in terms of preserving what Hollywood
yes.
represents.
Yes.
You know.
You're right now living in San Francisco, teaching at the University of
San Francisco State.
State.
Mm-hmm.
Teaching the young people tap dance and all that? Or
well,
what is it?
Not really tap
no?
dance, no. The course that I teach is called the Complete Actor Director.
Okay.
And basically it has I teach a 2-hour session.
Right.
And I usually start it off with a little movement.
Right.
You know, getting them up into.
Right. Uh-huh.
You know, getting their bodies moving.
Least.
Because actors have to be able to move.
Right.
You know what I mean?
Yeah.
So
body language.
Yeah, body language.
Right, of course.
And they have to know where the muscles are and what they're
mm-hmm.
doing and
mm-hmm.
how to control them.
Mm-hmm.
So I started off with that. And then we uh-huh. go into scene. Then we start doing physical mimes.
Uh-huh. Well, that's great.
And then we do the same mime in slow motion.
Mm-hmm.
Trying to create the control of slow motion, you
yes,
know,
yes.
really uh-huh. fun. And they're all, I love it the first time I give that exercise to class because when I say, come on, okay, well now I'll do a slow motion, right?
Uh-huh.
They don't really feel the weight of that
yes.
until they start to do it. And they can't, they are absolutely surprised how little control they have without actually working on it very specifically, you know.
You came up with something great, though. Come Tap With Me, Gene
Wilson. Yeah, how about that?
I love it. Come Tap With Me. You have a video out right now. A video.
A double video.
A double.
Yeah.
I like to see. You have a clip you brought from this video.
Yes, right.
I love to see a clip from this
video. Well,
can we see this?
Sure, let's look at it.
Well, you did this at the Debbie Reynolds Studio?
Yes,
Okay, I like to see it.
We did it last May.
Last May?
Okay. Yeah.
Good. Let's roll it.
This next exercise requires considerable balance. So when you're practicing it, you might want to get a kitchen chair, or if you're at the sink, hold on, or just grab onto anything that's handy. Okay. All right, we're going to learn the shuffle, okay? Shuffle, 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 step. Shuffle, 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 step. Shuffle, 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 step. Shuffle, 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 step. That's it. All right, now go back to the toes. Back to the flat.
Working that video is great.
That was just the tap one and two.
Tap one, two. That is the shuffle tape. Off. That's the beginning of it.
Well, that's pretty close to the beginning,
okay.
Yeah.
Now, I'd like to get back with you. On West Point, that was with James Cagney. Tell me about this great man, James Cagney. That's a great movie. Doris Day, James Cagney.
Virginia Mayo was
in
it, too.
Virginia Mayo,
yeah,
and Gene Nelson.
Yeah,
come on, you were one of the cadets in that.
Absolutely.
Great.
And Alan Hale Jr. was in it. Right. Oh, bless his old heart.
That was taped at Warner's, right? Tell me about that movie.
What?
I love that movie.
It was fun. Jimmy had a kind of story. Jimmy had a bugaboo about doing certain things in black and white or color.
Right.
His theory was, if you do a picture about prison,
black and white.
It has to be black and white.
Right.
Because of that contrast, and you know, you put color on, and the uniforms look nice, and they look all pretty, and he absolutely, and because this was West Point, which is the gray.
Yes, yes.
He said he would not do the picture unless it was black and white.
I see.
So we did it in black and white. I mean, he was satisfied.
Was it fun working with him, though?
Huh?
Was it fun, Gene, working with?
You know, he was the first actor that ever hit me.
Hit you?
I mean, on stage hit. You know.
Yeah.
And he taught me how to take a blow. He was. Every night we finished at 6 o'clock or whatever. We go to his dressing room, and he'd get the gin out, you know, a little gin and tonic.
Right.
And I'd say, what about this? And I'd be there at 8, 9 o'clock. He'd be telling me all the old days of Warner Brothers, and you know, when.
Did you both drink together?
Huh?
Did you both drink?
Yeah? Oh yeah. Oh god. And he kept telling me these stories. But getting back to West Point, knowing he had to dance a little bit in this,
right?
He would start off by going to the rehearsal hall, and he had a tire, a truck inner tube tire,
right,
which he cut. I mean, about that wide, and it would cover about this much of his waist because he always had a roll, you know, like me now. And he would slip on. Right?
Did he really?
Yeah, and the rubber. Would not allow the skin to breathe, and you'd sweat more.
Right.
See, which would help, you know, melt the fat down. And he'd go to the rehearsal hall, and he'd dance for two or three hours.
With this robe?
With this...
interesting.
With this inner tube around
his
waist, you know? And he started doing that, I'd say about 3 weeks before we started shooting, okay, getting himself ready for what he had to do. Uh-huh. Oh, he was such a marvelous man.
How did Gene Nelson become a director? What made Gene Nelson turn into directing films? You directed Elvis Presley.
Yeah.
Several films with Elvis Presley. Two?
Mm-hmm.
Which were they?
Kissin' Cousins and Harum Scarum.
Kissin' Cousins.
Yeah, I co-wrote that too.
You did?
Yeah.
Tell me about working and directing with this great man, Elvis Presley. At that time, did you think he was going to be that great? Such a legend?
Well, I've got to confess.
Go ahead.
That my introduction to that whole world, which was the Hootenanny,
right. You know,
that era, was kind of weird. I was called by Sam Katzman. You remember Sam
Katzman?
Of course,
dear old Sam. One of the great.
He left Columbia after making millions for
right.
them, went over to MGM and opened up his Four Leaf Productions over there.
Mm-hmm.
He called me, and I was shooting I Dream of Jeannie at the time, television show, and he called me over and said, "I want you. I got a musical I want you to do," mm-hmm. and it was called Hootenanny Hoot.
Right.
With Rita Lee, and Peter Breck.
Mm-hmm.
And we had, in this thing, we had 10 of the most famous, including Johnny Cash,
uh-huh.
Hootenanny acts. They were called Hootenanny acts
right.
then, you know? And the picture was scheduled for 9 days.
Uh-huh. 9 days?
I did 16 pages a day. I used 3 cameras.
Uh-huh.
It wasn't my first picture. It wasn't my first film. But
right.
Anyway, we did the thing, and we got all these marvelous Hootenanny acts in
right.
there. And this was my first introduction to this kind of music. The point is, this was my first introduction to this kind of music. Hillbilly music,
hillbilly,
basically,
yeah,
you know,
yeah.
that kind
Western
of stuff.
Western hillbilly, right.
And rock was coming in, and you know, and I didn't know from rock. I didn't care much for it either.
Right.
And the second picture I did for Sam was very close after that. He liked what I did with...
Right.
With the Hootenanny Hoot, I finished in 8.5 days. and for him, that was a miracle.
Was Elvis a good listener, a good actor?
Oh, yes. He was a lot better actor than he was ever given a chance to be.
He was?
Oh, yeah. I mean, the kind of stories that they did, including the two I did,
right.
were so simplistic. The characters were so shallow, basically.
Right.
You know what I mean?
Yes.
But when, in almost every picture,
uh-huh.
if you're looking, there's a moment or a scene or something or other where you can really see the potential of this kid as an actor.
Uh-huh.
He was terrific. He was so shy. Boy, I mean,
he was shy.
Pulling eye teeth to get past this. Uh-huh. But a cute thing he did to me. We're doing Kissin' Cousins.
Right.
And we have this huge big set at MGM Stage 25 of Hillbilly. House at the top of the, Glenda Farrell was the mother, mm-hmm. and Arthur O'Connell the father. Wonderful. We had this big dance number,
right?
And they were lighting big area, mm-hmm. took time. So I'm sitting in my director's chair with my script, and I'm kind of checking my shots and
right.
so forth. And I hear somebody come up behind me, and he said, "Mr. Nelson." And I said, "Hi, Elvis. What can I do for you?" He says, "I'm not bothering you, am I?" He would never call me Gene. He never called any person Gene. It was either Miss or Mister. I mean, you know, no matter how much
that's a Southern pots. They're polite.
Absolutely genteel and polite. I said, "No, sit down." You know, and so he says, "You know," he says, "Do you remember coming to Memphis with a little blonde girl?" And you were riding on the back of a convertible Lincoln, and on the side had some banners that said, "She's working her way through college." Do you remember that? I said, "Yeah, that was when we were doing a PR tour
uh-huh.
for the picture, and it was Virginia Gibson sitting next to me." Uh-huh. And he says, "Well, you drove by the Memphis Theater." I was an usher there. And when I heard you were coming by, I ran out of the theater
uh-huh.
and stood on the curb uh-huh. with everybody else to see you go by. And it's just because I just think your pictures were terrific. And he went on and on. I was getting embarrassed, you know. But how sweet of him to have him.
We were like three or four days into the picture before this ever happened,
you know. Yes. But he's very thoughtful, very kind. Because these pictures are very difficult because of the musical and the time and everything else. Yeah, a couple of times when I was kind of hurting, I was in trouble time-wise, he would come up to me and says, "You okay? He says, you need any more time for this?" You know what I mean? He says, "Because I can get sick awful." Isn't that something?
That's great.
I mean,
he has some fond memories of Elvis Presley.
Oh,
that's
great. Absolutely. I would have liked to have known him better.
Gene, come tap with me again. I want to go back into that clip. We just showed a little thing. What's this other thing we're going to show right now at the end of the... I love to show just that little clip of you're talking about. What is that?
That's the end of the tape.
End of the tape? I just love to see it.
Okay,
Can I show it, Don?
Yeah.
Let's hear it. Just show that.
Come back again, huh?
You bet.
Oh, Mr. Nelson.
Get up.
May I have your autograph, please?
Why, sure, honey.
Gee, I sure wish I could be a dancer like you.
Now, what makes you think you can't?
Oh, gee, I just can't, that's all.
Oh, it's easy. All you gotta do is try.
I say you gotta be a doer. Doers are getting fewer. Here's the reason why. You'll find a lot of wishful thinkers with blinkers who sit around and watch the world go by. Don't be an oh why was I borner, sitting in the corner sighing a great big sigh. If you want to be a kingpinner, a winner, it's easy. All you gotta do is try. Starting position.
Showers of
Shower of Stars, CBS.
Right.
1954. Yeah, and that was an all-star show that I also did the staging and choreography for, and then I appeared in it.
How does Gene Nelson feel when he sees his old movies on television in San Francisco when you turn on when you're late night?
I've been seeing them now for so long. I some things I look at and I say, okay. Uh-huh. Other things I look at, God, I wish I hadn't done that.
You know? Gene Nelson, looking back over your career.
Yeah.
Would you do it the same way?
No.
Really?
No.
What would you do?
I'd be smarter.
Really?
Yeah.
Smarter. What do you mean by
well,
smarter?
See, a theatrical career is a collection of choices.
Right.
Okay. Timing, place, time, all of that enters into it. When given an opportunity to make a choice, there are a number of choices that I would have reconsidered, you know. I mean, we don't have time to go into the whole theory. But basically speaking, yes, I have a fair share of regrets and a fair share of choices that I would rather have made. You know,
is Gene Nelson spiritual?
I think I am. I'm not religious, but I think I'm spiritual.
Mm-hmm. You are. You look good to me. You look very happy, very content.
Well, that must be from living in San Francisco. Well, it's not bad for a 70-year-old man, huh?
How many times have you been married, Gene? Twice.
Twice.
Any children?
I have three children, three wonderful kids.
Really?
My older son, Chris, is a very fine film editor here in town. He just finished doing John... what's his name? Oh, isn't that awful?
It's okay.
Film, anyway. And he was on China Beach for quite a while, and a lot of things. My second marriage, I have two, Doug and Victoria, and they are not in the business at all.
Did you have happy times and happy memories in New York when you were in the theater in New York?
Always. I always enjoyed going to New York, but yet I always enjoyed coming back too. Like, I lived in New York two or three times, and I did shows
right. For
8 months, a year and a half, you know. I love New York when I was working. I love working in New York because the pulse there is so great. It really is.
Energy.
Oh, yeah. Everybody's got something going. Everybody's trying to improve, and you see it visually.
San Francisco has that too, Gene, a little, would you
yes,
say?
Yes, much more so than...
Everybody, welcome back to Looking at Hollywood, starring our host Skippy Lowe. Today we have a talent extraordinaire, an international film star. We have the great, the one and only Mr. Cesar Romero. And this gives me my opportunity to finally thank him for all the wonderful things he's created that I've been able to enjoy. I mean, without Cesar Romero, I never would have been able to have a Caesar salad. Without Cesar Romero, I never would have been able to stay at Caesar's Palace. And without Cesar Romero, we never would have had Sid Caesar. So why don't we have some champagne with Cesar and Skippy?
Cesar, you were telling me before you went to prep school. Your family sent you to a prep school?
Yes, I went to collegiate school in New York.
Right.
Riverdale School first, and then collegiate school.
Uh-huh.
But my father had lost everything in the sugar market crash, so when I didn't go to college, but he got me a job at the National City Bank in Wall Street, and I hated it. You know?
Did you really?
Oh, yes.
Is that where Cesar Romero became a ballroom dancer then?
No, I was always a good dancer. I was always a great dancer as a kid.
Uh-huh.
My Lord, yes. Uh-huh. I started dancing when I was 5 years old.
Really?
I learned how to dance with the cook in the kitchen. We had a Puerto Rican cook we had for years. She used to love to dance. She used to dance me around the kitchen.
Uh-huh.
But I didn't... I was on that list, and I went to all the Deb parties in New York, you know. And I had a friend of mine, Elizabeth Higgins, who was a beautiful dancer, and she wanted to dance professionally, and she had the approval of her family.
Right.
And she said to me one day, she said, let's you and I be a dance team. We can work in all those wonderful nightclubs that existed in New York in those days.
Right.
So I said, fine, you know, because dancing was fun for me.
Mm-hmm.
And I used to get together with Liz at night after I finished working at the bank.
Right.
And then one day she said, look, how much money are you making at the bank? Well, I was only making $17.50 a week. And I paid $7.50 for my room, and I lived on the other $10. You could do that in New York in those days, you know.
Uh-huh.
This is back in 1926. And my family were living in New Jersey. They didn't know what I was up to. So I didn't want to say I'm only making $17.50 a week. I'm making $25 a week.
Uh-huh.
And she said, well, if you quit your job, I'll pay your salary so we can work all day and rehearse all day and go out and give some auditions.
Uh-huh.
I said, fine. So I quit my job and I got a big raise in salary right off the bat. Uh-huh. And we went out and gave auditions and we got a job in a musical comedy called Lady Do.
Lady Do.
Lady Do. The star of the show was a female impersonator.
Uh-huh.
Yeah,
do you remember the name of that female impersonator? Because it was very rare those days.
He was known as the Creole Fashion Plate.
Okay.
Yeah.
Yes, I remember that.
Yeah.
That's an old fashion.
What was his real name, dear? Carl Norman.
Carl Norman. Carol
Norman.
Uh-huh.
Carol Norman.
Uh-huh.
He was a big star in those
right,
days.
Exactly.
So that's what started us off, and I danced for the next 4 years with her
uh-huh.
and other partners.
Mm-hmm.
And then I got a call from an agent, Chamberlain Brown.
Right.
You know, he handled all the big people in the theater in those
Broadway
days.
Stars,
oh,
all
yes.
that, yes, of course.
And he said, do you think you can play the lead in Strictly Dishonorable? Well, I, you know, what could I lose? I said, sure, you know,
uh-huh.
I never played
uh-huh.
a part. And he got me an appointment with Chamberlain Brown and Antoinette Perry.
Right.
You know, the one, the Tony Awards, the name for her. You know?
Right.
And they said, well, what have you done? I've said a few lies, you know. And they said, come back tomorrow and read for us.
Uh-huh.
Well, I'd seen the play, and I went and saw it again that night.
Right.
And when I went back the next day, I gave as good an imitation of Carminati, because I never took my eyes off him, you know.
Uh-huh.
And I guess it was pretty good because they signed me to a run of the play contract. And I played, I did Strictly Dishonorable on the road for a year.
And never studied acting?
No.
Never
Caesar
studied anything. Never did study?
No.
Even now today, even when you were in 20th and all as an actor, never took a lesson?
No.
Just being yourself?
Well, that happens to a lot of people.
It
a lot
does.
Of people have never gone
never
to
acting schools.
No, never. The girl, my leading lady's understudy
right.
in Strictly Dishonorable was a young girl just starting out on her career, and she went on to become a big star
mm-hmm.
in the theater and in motion pictures. Mm-hmm. Her name was Margaret Sullivan.
Great actress.
Yes.
Great. One of the greatest actresses. Valentino. You and Valentino have so much in common because of the Latin lovers. And the come on, Cesar Romero.
Everybody with a
they
Latin.
They compared you with Valentino.
Well, because
you came to Hollywood, really.
But a Latin name. Anybody with a Latin name was compared to
no,
to Valentino.
Not just not anyone with a Latin name. You happen to be the tall, elegant, dark, suave.
Yeah, well, I played a lot of mugs and
gangsters. You did gangster films.
Oh, sure.
Tell me about those movies, your gangsters, cowboy movies. You did cowboy films?
Well, not too many.
You did a couple. Cisco Kid.
The Cisco Kid. I did.
You had a series.
I did six Cisco Kid pictures.
You did six of them?
Oh, yes.
That was a series, like.
Yeah.
Saturday afternoons, I used to see them. My mother used to take me to the theater on Saturday afternoon, Annie.
Oh.
And I used to go see the Cisco Kids.
But I, you know, I did my first picture at MGM.
Was that your first at the MGM?
Yeah, The Thin Man.
The Thin Man
MGM
was your...
MGM brought me out here, you know.
Right.
They saw me in a... Ben Piazza, who was the casting director for MGM, saw me in a play.
Uh-huh.
And he came back and said, I'd like to make a screen test of you. And I did. And the result of that test, they signed me to a contract. But I didn't last with them at all. It was a contract for one picture, option of another picture,
right.
you know, option of 6 months.
Because you were a 20th. Actually, you were a 20th
well,
century
I know,
Fox,
but I was
Caesar.
I was a Universal for 3 years before that.
Oh, how about The Shadow Laughs?
That was
your very first dream?
Well, that was in New York.
Oh, was that in New York?
Oh, that was in New York. I don't consider that at all.
Really?
I was practically an extra in that picture, you know.
Uh-huh.
No, I don't consider that my first picture.
What did you do at Universal? You said you were Universal?
Universal, I played opposite. My first picture at Universal was opposite Fay Wray.
Fay?
In a picture called Cheating Cheaters.
Uh-huh.
And I did Diamond Jim Brady, you
right.
know. With,
right, right.
And I did a lot of... corny pictures up
no,
there.
You did not do corny
Armored
pictures. You know what you did? You did entertaining pictures. Today, they're not entertaining. They're
well,
those days, look at Caesar. Think, really. Watch the movies today.
Listen, it's very different today. My God, the industry is different.
Like what? Tell me.
Well, I mean, the studios don't, they don't control.
System. They don't have a system.
Of course not. The studio, most of the production in Hollywood today is television. Mm-hmm. It's not motion pictures. Motion pictures are done all over the country, all over the world.
Right. I see.
Hollywood is no longer the motion picture capital of the world. That's...
How was it for Cesar Romero when you first arrived here in Hollywood, Cesar? You were young, you were dashing.
It was wonderful. We were all under contract to studios. And everybody knew each other from all the different studios,
right.
You know. It was like a big family.
Uh-huh.
And there was a very definite motion picture colony in those days.
Right.
And within that motion picture colony was a very elegant society. At all the social functions in this town, you'd see every big star would be there. Mary Pickford, Charlie Chaplin, Douglas Fairbanks. I mean, everybody.
Right.
Everybody. There was a social thing in Hollywood. And Mary was the queen, and Marion Davies, the wonderful parties she used to give. You know, Hearst would come in and have the studio... turn the two tennis courts out of the beach into anything she wanted.
Yes.
A Spanish town, a circus.
Uh-huh.
I mean, those days are gone forever. But I'm so glad that I had all those years because it's so very different now, you know?
Uh-huh.
There's you don't have that feeling of community together. You know?
But it was glamour. That was
well, of course it was glamorous.
People never used to go out without their makeup or their hair. Stars.
And
it was very
important. Everybody was dressed properly.
Right.
At all times.
Never saw jeans.
No.
Ever. Or sneakers.
Sneakers and open shirts.
Yes.
And at openings today, you see people in shirt sleeves and open. Come on.
Movie stars. They wanted to see movie stars. That's what Hollywood was. It was a fantasy land. It was real. It was classy then, wasn't it?
Oh, it sure was.
Cesar Romero, you go out a lot in this town.
Yes,
a lot
I do.
With Civil Brown every night, practically. How do you do this? What is your secret, Cesar?
Well,
you're not a young man, you know.
No,
you're in your what? 80s.
I'm 85.
And he looks marvelous.
80, Annie.
I'll be 86 in 4 months.
86. He's Romero.
Why, sure.
Getting back to Hollywood.
I've been around a long time.
Yeah, you did a movie I loved at 20th. What happened to 20th? Was your first film at 20th? Because I love that studio.
Well, my first picture at 20th Century Fox was, my first picture was Zanuck.
Zanuck,
well,
yes.
I did three pictures for Zanuck while I was still under contract to Universal.
Oh, really?
He borrowed me. I did Clive of India.
Right.
With Ronald Coleman and Loretta Young.
Mm-hmm.
And I did Cardinal Richelieu. I played opposite Maureen O'Sullivan in it,
right.
You know.
Your
Cardinal
friend.
Richelieu the star, George Arliss,
yes.
You know.
Uh-huh.
And then I did Metropolitan.
Ah.
With Lawrence Tibbett. And I played opposite Virginia Bruce in it, you know.
Wonderful, Lawrence Tibbett.
And Alice Brady.
Uh-huh.
Those were all when Zanuck was making his pictures on the United Artists lot. It was just 20th Century Pictures.
Mm-hmm.
Then he moved to Fox, and it became 20th Century Fox. And I did the first picture under contract, still at Universal.
Right.
I did the picture called Show Them No Mercy. It was the first picture on the Fox lot.
Who was in it?
No big stars.
Bruce
Cabot.
That was the first film on the lot?
Bruce Cabot, Rochelle Hudson was the girl,
uh-huh.
Warren Heimer. And you know, uh-huh. It was a great, wonderful picture. It was one of my favorite pictures. And then I did.
Why
still,
is that your favorite picture? Cesar?
Because it was a good picture and it was a damn good role.
Uh-huh.
We were a bunch of kidnappers, you know. In those days, there were a lot of big kidnappings around the country, and it was very timely.
Uh-huh.
But then I did, and I was still under contract to Universal.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
Then I did Clive of India. I mean, Wee Willie Winkie.
Right. See. You know, Cesar, I love this lady so much, and I'm sure you do, too. You must have great fond memories. Betty Grable.
Oh, yeah.
Love Betty Grable.
I did about...
I did about
four or five pictures with Betty.
You brought a clip, and I want to show you. I'm going to surprise you with this clip. I love this clip. It's great. I love this movie of Betty Grable and you in this film.
Well...
Let's show it, huh?
Give me an opportunity to dance in it.
Yeah.
Okay,
Yeah, let's see it. Let's
great.
See Cesar Romero and Betty Grable.
All right, let's see it.
Come in. Harry. Why, I thought you were... lovely surprises.
Vicky, Vicky, Vicky. I thought so. Time has only succeeded in making you more exquisite.
Thank you. Hi.
Hello, Phoebe. You haven't changed. Vicky Lane in person. Not a facsimile, but the real thing in the flesh.
And a couple of pounds too much of it. That was always one good thing about dancing with you, Victor. You were so strenuous, you kept me down to 110.
That wasn't the only good thing about dancing with me, I hope. couldn't we have a little chat?
5 minutes, Miss Lane.
Oh, thanks, Tommy. I'm sorry, Victor, but the show must go on. Phoebe, will you tell Dan I'd like to see him before our number?
Oh, Victor.
Gosh, it's been almost a year, hasn't it?
A year of thinking of you, Vicky. No, there wasn't a day of my tour that I didn't miss you. I kept seeing your reflection in Louisiana bayous and Arizona sunsets. No one could ever replace you, Vicky. There'll never be another Victor in Victoria. Come back, Vicky.
Oh, that's nice, Victor, but...
I've got the finest hotels in the country, all of them waiting for you. And of course, you know, my heart is waiting, too.
Well, I've got 2,000 people waiting for me, so I...
Oh, Vicky! I've got a new step. I call it the Victor.
Oh,
it
later,
goes like
Victor.
This.
Am I late? See, I'm late. Goodbye.
Goodbye.
Oh, God, wow. Caesar, that's so good. Betty Grable, working with Betty Grable. Beautiful lady. Beautiful. Just beautiful.
She was wonderful to work with.
Was she?
Yeah, she had a lovely sense of humor. She was a lot of fun to work
Harry
with.
Harry James was in this?
Yes, that's where...
John Payne...
John Payne, Carmen Miranda, Charlotte Greenwood,
Charlotte Greenwood, the ladies.
Everett Horton.
Uh-huh.
It was a great cast.
Carmen Miranda. Must have been very close to you guys. Latin and carrying on. Was she crazy and there were a lot on the set?
No, she really wasn't in real life.
Really?
You know, but she worked that way, you know. She murdered the English language.
Uh-huh.
And when she started, you know, she was very new she was a novelty, uh-huh. You know. People uh-huh. had never seen anybody like that before.
Big platforms like that?
That's right.
Tiny little girl.
So she was very popular there for a while.
Uh-huh.
But towards the end, Carmen had trouble, you know, because she never changed.
Same thing.
She never changed. She was still singing. uh-huh. You know, and by that time, after a few years of that, it was no novelty anymore.
Right.
Towards the end, she was having a hard time.
Did Betty Grable meet Harry James? Were they married at that time? Or
no,
did they meet on the set and they fell in love and they got married?
No, they weren't married at that
time. They weren't?
No, indeed.
How did
That's what started that.
That's what started?
Certainly.
Springtime in the Rockies. John Payne. Loved this guy. Great.
Yeah.
He never studied acting. This guy was just an ordinary good actor. Tell me about John Payne. I really liked him.
Well, John, I remember John when he first started in the business. He and Lee Bowman were roommates. They had an apartment next to mine, you know.
Mm-hmm.
And he started, I think, John started, he was under contract to Goldwyn,
I think. Samuel Goldwyn, yes.
Yeah,
yes, he was.
When he started. But he was a very popular leading man, you know.
Loved motorcycles, I know that.
20th Century Fox.
Motorcycles, he loved.
Well...
Yeah, he did. He was one of the Hollywood early motorcycle guys before Marlon Brando and Jimmy Dean and all those guys.
Oh, I don't remember
no,
that.
No, you don't? I've read something about it. Tales of Manhattan. Come on, Cesar Romero. My favorite film.
Your favorite film?
One of my favorites. It's
God,
a great film.
Everybody Tales. Under the sun was in that picture.
I know it.
It was a story of a suit of tails.
Wonderful.
But I was in the episode with Ginger Rogers and Henry Fonda.
Fonda. Working with Henry Fonda.
That's the only time I worked with Henry. I never worked with him.
Never before.
In all the years we were at Fox together.
Is that the first time? You used to see him on the lot a lot.
And I never worked with Ginger either until then.
Cesar Romero, tell me about the commissary, the 20th Century Fox commissary, Annie. It was wonderful. I used to go there as a kid. Because I did a movie there years ago for Henry King. I can't remember the name of it.
Yeah.
But I used to go to the commissary. That commissary was the greatest in Hollywood. Tell me about that.
Well, you'd go there for lunch. It was always, you know, you knew where you were going. We had lunch in the little room on the side
but
there.
But the people, the stars, but
everybody,
my God.
But everybody under the sun would have lunch there.
Right.
You saw everybody you knew.
Uh-huh.
It was, I mean, you took it...
All day working, going out at night. You had to go out, and you had to go to Searles, McCombell's.
Yeah, but when we were working the pictures, we didn't go out
you
at
didn't
night.
Go out?
Oh, no. No, no, no. I'm sorry, I can't go out. I'm working tomorrow.
I see. How was Searles those days and McCombell's and...
Well, the greatest supper club we had in this town was the Trocadero.
Trocadero.
That was the place.
Is that where... yes, that was the greatest. Who's oh. some of the stars performed there? They had a...
Well, you know, on Sundays they had sort of a... not a contest, but young performers come up there, you know. One of them was Ann Miller.
Was she there? Oh. That's how she got discovered?
Oh, well, yes.
Did Ann Miller get discovered in one of those places?
Yeah, she was. I used to see Ann rehearsing in the rehearsal hall at, I forget, who were the producers, big producers for shows in movie houses?
I don't know. It doesn't matter.
And I saw her rehearsing. Mm-hmm. In one of the rehearsal halls mm-hmm. there, this young girl, you know, and then the next time I saw her, she was hoofing it at the Trocadero.
Tell
but
me.
That was a great club, you know. It was the best supper club we ever had in this town.
Tails. You used to go in tuxedos. People used to dress
really?
In tuxedos, not suits. And tuxedos yeah. in the evening. Wasn't it? That's the way to go, to
yeah.
go to dinner.
And we used to have a lot of affairs here at Tao. You'd be in white tie.
Uh-huh.
White tie and tails. I remember the ball that Carol Lombard was the chairperson for it.
Uh-huh.
And she decreed that all the women would wear white and the men would wear white tie and tails. And it was beautiful. All the women were dressed in white except one.
Uh-huh.
Norma Shearer came in bright red from head to foot.
Uh-huh.
Nobody was going to tell her
uh-huh.
what to wear.
I like it.
Cesar Romero, what's the biggest lesson you have learnt in life? Because you're 80-some years old. God, what has been the biggest lesson for Cesar Romero?
My lesson has been to have tolerance for people and respect for people.
I like that. Tolerance.
Tolerance and respect.
Uh-huh. That's nice. Have you ever turned a part down
oh, yes.
that you have regretted later?
Oh, no.
That you have regretted later?
No.
No?
No. But I took one, I think, suspension years ago.
Uh-huh.
And then I saw, I said, this is for the birds, you know,
uh-huh, uh-huh.
because you're off salary and they attach that time to a contract.
Right, right.
So I said, this is no good. So I never took I did what the studio told
uh-huh.
me to do. And I played, you know, when they assigned me to a picture, uh-huh. I did it. And I did the best job I could for them. And I had a long, long
How many
career
films has...
doing.
Cesar Romero has done
over
100?
Over 100, yes.
One of my favorites here, another one of my favorites, Captain from Castile. I'm
yes.
going to Tyrone Power in you.
Yes.
Let's show this clip.
Well, he was one of my
dearest
friends.
We're going to talk to him.
Friends,
yes, I know.
You know.
Let's show this clip, Captain from Castile. Cesar Romero.
Your name? Pedro de Vargas.
Sign here. Where from?
I am Spain.
Are you a relative of Francisco de Vargas?
His son, sir.
I'm Hernan Cortes. Our fathers were friends. Though mine never reached the eminence of yours. Your illustrious father as well?
When I last saw him, sir.
I'm delighted to have you join us in this venture. If you've the spirit and merit of your father, you'll prove worthy of promotion and a command.
Thank you, Captain.
A gentleman, a good omen, the son of Francisco de Vargas joins our company. This is Corio, the first officer of the Gallega. This is Captain Sandoval.
Captain.
Senor Duque. Captain Alvarado.
Welcome to the expedition.
Thank you, Captain. This is our chaplain, Father Bartolome de Olmedo.
Father.
Brothers. And here we have Senor Juan Escudero and Senor Diego Sermano.
Señores.
These two gentlemen are representatives of His Excellency the Governor of Cuba. They came from Santiago at the last moment to relieve me of my command. But I believe I've successfully convinced them that I am going to be the captain of this company, or there isn't going to be any captain. Eh, gentlemen? And who might you be?
Katana Perez, sir.
One of our ladies, eh? We've quite a few in the army already. Some married and some in hopes of it. You know, sometimes I think you women will end up with more gold out of this one way or the other than any of us. You wish to inscribe your name in the roll of the company, little one?
Oh, yes, sir. Thank you, my lord.
Oh. I can't believe it. Jane Peters. Tyrone Power, best
that was,
friend.
You that was Jean's first picture.
Was that Jean Peters' first?
Yes.
She was gorgeous.
Her first picture.
She was married to Howard Hughes.
Well, she wasn't married then.
Yeah, no, but this was after.
Well, quite a time after
yeah.
because she married somebody else first, you
Who
know.
Who did she marry first?
I forget, but
Doesn't matter.
She was divorced, and then she married Howard.
Tyrone Power, best of friends. He was a flyer. He was a great guy. You guys were close together. You were in the Flyers together.
He was my very, very close friend. I had one of the best experiences of my life with Tyrone. He was a flyer, you know,
right.
in the war, in the Marine Corps.
Right.
And I was in the Coast Guard. I was in an attack transport out in the Pacific. And we both got out of the service at the same time.
Right.
And we reported back to the studio. And they sent us on this trip. Right. And the studio provided us with a twin-engine Beechcraft, and Ty did all the flying. And we flew down through Mexico, we hit every country in Central America, and we circled all of South America. We went down the western coast, down to Santiago, Chile, through the pass to Buenos Aires,
right.
up over the Guianas, the West Indies, Havana, Havamani, New York, California. We were 10 weeks on this trip. It's a wonderful experience. You know, we met practically all the presidents of the countries that we visited, because the first person we had to meet was the American ambassador. And the ambassador introduced us to the president either at luncheon or a meeting or cocktails or dinner. And the most interesting ones were when we had lunch with Perón and Evita.
Oh, did you?
In the palace at Buenos Aires. She was a charming
was
woman.
Was she really?
Oh, yes. She didn't speak English. So I interpreted for her, you know, because, and Perón didn't speak English either.
Right.
And she was very amusing. She'd sit there, she'd say to me, she said, why do the people in your country call my husband a dictator? She said, he's not a dictator, he's a patriot. Isn't that right, Juan? You're a patriot, aren't you? And Perón said, sí, yes. she would say things like, you're so fortunate because the people in your country respect and love their artists.
Right.
She said, here in my country, they spit at them. She said, I know because I was an artist.
Caesar, Tyrone Power, what a classy guy.
Oh, yes.
He was classy, wasn't
yes,
he?
Yes, he was. And he loved his work. He loved his work. He loved being a star.
Uh-huh.
He loved it.
He did enjoy being a star.
Oh, yes, he loved every minute of it.
He married Linda Christian. Were you at the wedding in Rome when they got married?
No. He married in Rome.
They got married, and I interviewed Linda, and she was telling me about the greatest marriage ever in
Rome. They
love him all over the world.
Yes, well.
And he had to die in Spain, his favorite place, where he loved. Isn't that in Madrid? And you know, I was in Madrid at the time when this happened. And,
oh, really?
Yeah, and I was terrified. My heart just broke. Believe in fate?
I did the eulogy at his funeral.
Did you really?
Yes, and I said, I'll never do this again, ever.
Tore your heart.
Oh,
he was your best friend.
And he'd been dead about a week, you know, and he just looked awful in that casket. And he was married to...
Annabella?
No. Annabella was his first wife.
His first wife, yes.
You know.
She was great, though.
He should never have divorced her. She divorced him.
She divorced him. I heard this.
Sure.
Do you believe in fate, Caesar?
Well, I guess so.
Yeah. You keep going on, Caesar. Let's face it, you go out every night. What is Caesar Romero's secret? What do you eat? What is your secret? Because you look so great.
No.
Your hair, everything, your skin.
No secret.
It's the genes.
Just trust your luck. It's your genes. I think that has a lot to do with it.
I think the way you think peacefully. What is the day like for you? What time of the day you get up, Caesar Romero?
I get up around 7 o'clock in the morning.
Okay. Do you walk?
No, I don't walk. I can't walk long distances. I have a problem with my back and my hips. You know, I have a few problems that I have to take
What would you think is the greatest achievement that you have achieved in your life
Caesar?
My greatest achievement was to be able to take care of my family.
That's right. You take care of your mother.
I took care of my mother and my father and my sisters and my kid brother, and I put them through college.
That is wonderful.
That was my greatest achievement.
That is
wonderful. Was to take care of my family, and I took care of them. I had my mother and my father under my roof to the day they died.
Really, Caesar?
Wow.
You take good care of them. That is a secret. That is the secret of his life. See how wonderful. Caesar Romero, over 100 some films, Hollywood. Oh, come on. I mean, looking back. Any regrets about anything in life?
No.
You have no regrets about
anything? I have been so lucky. I wouldn't dare. No, indeed. I've had a lot of great luck in my life.
You still see all your friends in Hollywood. You still meet them at parties, all these wonderful people. Go ahead,
yes. Well, my group of friends have changed a great deal through the years,
right.
You know. People have changed. I see a great deal of Sybil Brand, as you know, and I see a lot of Anne Jeffries.
Yeah. You go out a lot with her.
And Henny Backus. They're my
close.
And Lee Minnelli. Those are the group that I sort of...
Tell me about Lee Minnelli. She's a nice lady. I've always wanted to really talk to her. I've spoken to her several times.
Well,
what a nice lady.
Yeah, she is. She is.
You surround yourself with nice people, Caesar.
Well,
I'm sitting here saying, God, you mentioned these wonderful names, Sybil Brand, Lee Minnelli. You surround yourself with...
Sybil Brand is a unique person in this town. What is...